I do a large number of Trinnov demos, and out of the box it does a great job already, but there's some really simple things that are worth knowing to help you get the best performance out of it. I'm going to run through the setup process with you and highlight some useful points. Hopefully it helps get you some great results. This is the first screen you're going to see when you first connect to your Trinnov Nova. It's the setup wizard that will guide you through the calibration process. And I'm just going to take you through some of the points that are going to be really useful in this. I'm just going to click next down here. And you see the first options we're going to get here are to use the Nova as a monitor controller or not. If you're going to use it as a monitor controller, you're going to probably want the La Remote option. We're not going to use it as a monitor controller today because I just want to really focus on the calibration process and how to get the best out of that. Clicking next here, the first screen thereafter is this matrix. This is going to show you the routing setup or allow you to change that routing setup. So I'm only going analog in and out as it's configured already by default. I can hide these digital inputs and outputs if I want to, just to simplify this. And you can see the analog input one is connected to analog output one, and similarly for two. So just clicking next. Usually I just call this the pair of speakers that I'm calibrating, which is today the lovely PMC62s. You can call it whatever you want, whatever works for you. You might call it flat, you might call it fun, or whatever, depending on the kind of configuration you're going to do. So once I've done that, click next. And we're going to go to a screen which is going to give the option to start the calibration down here. So I'm going to click that now. It's going to check the clock, which is at 48 kilohertz, as Trinnov recommend for the calibration. Click next. The microphone is connected already, and you can see the serial number for the microphone there. So I'm going to click next again, and the next few pages are just some instructions about how to calibrate and align your microphone and the speakers and everything like that. I'm going to explain this in person now, so we can skip that. So this is the first really important screen, I think. So I'm just going to bring the calibration level way down. This is going to play a white noise sound out of the speaker, and I certainly don't want it to be too loud to start with. And the way I like to do this is actually to flick to manual, and then this is going to let me just click on the individual outputs, and it's going to play some white noise through them. And my target, with the microphone in the correct place, which is going to be where my head is, I should see that SPL meter tickle around 80 dB or so. As you can see, it changes really quickly, so you just need to kind of get it as close as you can. It's not, you don't have to be absolutely perfect about it. So I'm just going to set the microphone up in the correct place now, and then I'm going to do these white noise tests, and you'll see this meter hopefully hitting 80 dB as Trinnov asks you to do so. The important thing when placing the microphone is that it goes approximately where your head would be, and that the tops of these microphones are at your ear height, which is quite easy to line up even without measuring, because it will pretty much be the same as your eye level. Thereafter, what you need to do is make sure that the mic is equidistant from both speakers. Use a tape measure, or if you want to be really flash, one of the laser tape measures you can get. And then you want to get the azimuth right, and that is the rotation of the microphone to make sure that it's exactly facing forwards. And there's a really good trick I've got when I'm setting the microphone up to try and get it as accurate as possible right off the bat. And that is, I take an eye line across the lower microphones and then visually line it up along the speaker, and then I do the same on the other side. And that will give me an approximation, really, as to how straight the microphone is, and I can adjust it accordingly. Once I've done a calibration measurement, I can see the azimuth on the screen, and we'll see that in just a moment, and see how accurate that is. Our aim is to probably get that within to like 1 or 2 degrees to get the best stereo image possible. So I've got the microphone correctly placed now. I've measured it and the angle visually looks as good as I can get it. So now I'm just going to hit this output, analog output one, and then get the right input level to the microphone now. And you can see I'm going to gradually turn this up until it hits 80 dB fairly consistently. That looks great. I'm just going to double check the other speaker as well. Spot on. Now we can move on to the next screen. You can perform multiple measurements if you want a potentially even more accurate response. For the most part, I find you don't need to. It's really good just with a single measurement. I'm going to switch from this top view over to details. And this is going to allow me to see the exact measurements that come in for the distance of the speaker, the elevation, which is obviously the height, and then azimuth, which is the rotation of the microphone within that. The elevation I find rarely is perfect, and that's quite often attributable to studio floors maybe not being quite even and things like that. I've never seen that perfectly match. I wouldn't worry too much about it, but the distance and the azimuth are certainly things we've got good control over. So we should certainly do our best to get those as accurate as possible. I believe I've got it, so I'm going to hit calibrate now and let's see how it comes out. Okay, looking at those results, I think that's about as close as you could ever really hope for. I've got the distance from each speaker exactly right. And the azimuth is within 0.1 of a degree. You can see it's a positive and negative figure, but they should match as closely as possible. And that's certainly within an acceptable realm as far as I'm concerned. You can see the elevation, as I said, doesn't quite match, but we're talking within, you know, fractions of a couple of degrees there, and it realistically isn't going to make a huge difference to the listening experience. So from here, I'm just going to hit compute and see what results we get. That computation is now done, so I'm going to click next. Congratulations, calibration completed. I'm going to go and see my results, so I'm going to click on graph down here. And we've got the before measurement here, the red line being the left speaker and the blue line being the right speaker. And the after results down here, which you can see are vastly flatter. Now this is actually really good, given this is basically a TV studio, not a proper recording studio, and there's minimal treatment in here at best at the moment. That's come out really good. This is probably better than some rooms I quite often see when I'm doing Trinnov demos, so I'm quite lucky. You can see here the before measurement at this point at 43 hertz, I'm getting nearly 14 dBs of too much bass. So most speakers in here do sound too bassy and not very clear at all. And this is a common pattern I see in a lot of studios as well, actually. This huge build up around this sort of area, followed by something of a notch around here. You can see, I mean, that's 11 dB on the red line there and minus 6. So that's 17 dBs of difference between 45 hertz and 125 hertz. It's going to cause a lot of problems in mixing and translation. And I think that is the area where 99.9% of people have issues and therefore have translation issues after. As you look up the frequency spectrum, you can see there's some other areas here. Look, minus 6 dB of 923 hertz, arguably one of the most sensitive areas of the human hearing. And not far above that, you know, a difference of around 9 or 10 dB or so. So not horrendous by any means. I've seen far worse measurements than this. I've seen far better, but this is the kind of a reasonably okay room that a lot of people are working in currently. And you know, there are very big differences between those frequency ranges. So when people are kind of saying to me, "Dan, I'm having real trouble with translation," well, this is why, a large part of it. So the Trinnov is correcting to a very, very flat line here, which is really, really nice. You can see it's not quite managed to get this all the way down here, and that's probably because we're asking it to cut around 14 dBs of gain there, and I mean, we can fix that if we want to. Certainly it's much more preferable to reduce these kind of large lumps, especially in the low end, rather than boost them. Because if I was to have like a huge hole, and I do see this from time to time at, you know, 30, 40 or 50 hertz, sometimes you get a big notch there. If you're going to boost that to flatten the frequency response, you're going to be asking the speaker to produce, you know, if that notch is 10 dBs low, then you're going to ask the speaker to produce an extra 10 dB of gain at that frequency. Now, that's going to take a really powerful speaker to produce an extra 10 dB at that sort of low frequency, which is where sometimes people can run into issues with distortion or even damaging their speakers. So this is why Trinnov are usually quite careful to say, like, you know, this is why the settings are as they are, you know, so that people don't actually go too overboard and damage them. It gives you the best kind of average rather than a perfect result. We can certainly achieve perfect results, and if our speakers are powerful and have got loads of headroom, maybe, you know, the 6.2s, for example, have got loads of power, but in a really big room, they might not have enough to go to a good volume. In a relatively small room like this, I could probably get away with fixing this. I'm not monitoring loud in here. I'm not doing production. I don't need it to be too loud and vibe or anything. It's, you know, I might be more focused at mixing here at really kind of low levels or reasonable levels. Therefore, I don't need to worry about losing the headroom that a big boost might you know, happen or cause. So as it is, you know, my room's pretty good. Really, I'm getting more reductions in this low end than anywhere else apart from this kind of 120 area. Anyway, let's get into what kind of problems I often see with Trinnov and what you can do to fix them. For example, how to smooth this bump out. And also, the other thing the Trinnov likes to try and do, bear in mind, no matter what speaker you calibrate with, it's going to try and extend it all the way down to 20 hertz. Now, there are very few speakers on the market that are meant to be flat to 20 hertz. Usually the more expensive good speakers go down to a sort of 30. And when I say more expensive speakers, I mean near fields primarily. Your mains, you know, quite often extend lower than that. But if you're calibrating head type 20s, PMC 62s, and so on, it's down to about 30 is really as low as you want to go. And I'll show you how to take care of that as well, so we're not making the speaker produce too low a frequency. So from here on, we're going to go into Optimizer up the top, and then click on Optimizer again in here. This is a new feature that Trinnov have recently brought in, by the way. It's a hardware bypass mode. Now, this actually makes it completely latency-free, so you'll bypass the calibration and go completely latency-free. And this is really handy for those people who are flicking between production and mixing. So if I'm playing some guitar in here or playing some keys and I'm monitoring through the speakers, I don't want to have a lot of latency involved. And the Trinnov calibration does bring in a fair amount of latency, around 35, 40 milliseconds or so. So having the hardware bypass mode is going to completely get rid of all the calibration, but also all of the delay, meaning that, you know, I can quickly just bypass the optimizer, play my part in, and then switch it back on again after if I really want to do that. So target curves is one area we want to look at quickly. If you're going to make any changes in here, by the way, just click link all, or make sure both of these boxes over here are ticked. That means that any changes you make are going to apply to both speakers, not just one. I've done it so many times myself where I've been tuning the curve a bit to, you know, a client's taste, for example, and then realize I've only done it on one speaker and you have to reset it all and do it again. It's a bit of a pain. But anyway, as you can see, the Trinnov here is trying to achieve, by the blue line, a completely flat response all the way down to 20 hertz. And that's fine for a bigger speaker. I certainly don't really want to get my PMC 62s going all the way down to 20 hertz, and largely under 20 hertz is you know, noise anyway. In fact, this graph is showing all the way down to 10 hertz. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to head over to settings, and I'm going to use this high pass frequency area, and I'm going to flick that onto 30 hertz, and then just hit apply. And what that's going to do, it won't show up on the target curve, but it will actually filter off the very low end, so that my speakers are not going to work too hard in that low frequency. And obviously you can change that setting to 50 hertz if it's a smaller speaker, wherever it is, you know. Look at the frequency response of the speaker according to the manufacturer and probably follow that. If you really want to get lower, you can do so, but bear in mind that's going to be at the expense of more headroom. The next thing to look at, as I said, was the kind of fixing some of the little bumps and lumps that you get sometimes that the Trinnov doesn't correct straight away. If you go into excursion curves, and this is an area that you need to be really careful about what you're doing, because this can kind of do some gnarly stuff if you've got a big notch. This is where if you make these adjustments, you can start getting your speaker to work too hard. But just as an example, because this one's not too bad, I've got this little line here which is extending outside the range of this blue line. Everything between these two blue lines is essentially getting corrected. So if I quite simply draw around that, maybe a little more, like that, and then we hit apply, what we're going to find is that the Trinnov should hopefully just pay a little bit more attention to that area and squeeze that line down and make it a little bit flatter. Now that excursion curve has been applied, we can see this little bump in the low end now been fixed and is much flatter. I think if I had a big notch there, I'd be a lot more careful about making that perfectly flat. Certainly, if you have that experience, it's worth trying, but just watch your speakers carefully. Make sure there's not too much excursion on the low end. Make sure they're not limiting or distorting or anything like that, because that's the kind of thing that could lead to failures in the speakers, and obviously we really want to avoid that. In most cases, if you want to be really careful, just don't touch the excursion curves at all. But a little bit of experimentation is not necessarily the worst thing. In all cases, if I'm getting a huge notch in the room, I'm definitely going to want to recommend that you look at playing with the speaker placement a little bit, and making sure that you've got the best positioning for the speakers in the room and minimizing any of those issues. Bumps are not such a big problem, but notches are a bigger headache really to deal with. So just don't be afraid to move the speakers, remeasure, try this a few times and just get a good feel for where the speakers are best placed in the room to minimize those issues. Next good tip, I think, is to set up a second preset that's perhaps a little more fun. Sometimes people like to switch between like a producer sound and an accurate mix sound. Obviously, perfectly flat being your accurate mix sound. A more sort of fun, vibey sound might involve adding a little bit of low end. Certainly in this room, I know, adding a little low end really helps. This room in particular, it's just the TV studio, but a flat response just feels a little bit thin. And I know in a really good room, flat can sound amazing, but in this room, I just need to make up for that sort of perceived thinness a little bit. Certainly if I add a little bump and I do some mixing and then send my mixes out and people are going, oh, you know, my mixes are not bassy enough, well, then I'm going to turn down that bump and then resend it and remix the audio based on that lower bump so that I add a bit more low end into that, if that makes sense. But anyway, let's have a look how to do that. So we're going to go into Optimizer again, and click on Target Curves. Remember to click Link All so we adjust all speakers at the same time. I'm going to simply draw in a little bump, 2 or 3 dB, something like that maybe. Nothing too scientific, but just a little fatness in the low end, which should sound really good. And we'll hit Apply. Now that's applied, let's have a look at the graph. And we can see the effect of that little bump in the low end, which will sound great. Now let's save that as a separate preset. So we'll go up here to the cog, go to Action, duplicate this. It will take the same measurement and apply it to a new preset. And I'll just call this one Fun or something like that. And then hit Save. So we'll see the effect of that. If I now flick back to here, this should be the flat setting. There we go. And if I flick to here, this will be the fun setting. So, and you can continue to make your own presets like that. You might have an artist couch at the back of the room. Well, stick the Trinnov mic there, do a measurement, see how it comes out. You might be able to achieve a more accurate sound for your artists who are maybe hearing a mix you've presented for them, rather than hearing, you know, the build-up of bass you often get at the back of rooms. Some people like that, but hey, it gives you the option. So what we've been over today is looking at the target curves and adjusting the sound of the Nova to your taste. We've looked at the excursion curves and the filtering so that we can get the flattest measurement possible, but also bearing in mind protecting our speakers from excessive low end. But ultimately, this should lead to getting really good mix translation, which hopefully makes your life a lot more fun and your work a lot more easy. Hopefully you find this video useful and it helps you get the best out of the Trinnov in your room. If you enjoyed this video, please like it and subscribe to our channel if you want to see more videos like this. See you again.